Inspector Edmund.
I want it done tonight.
Can't be done that quick.
He'll be at the Standard Hotel. He travels with a bodyguard. I want them both plugged before he does us any more damage.
Prime Minister, the Royal Irish Constabulary are demoralised and ineffective. In some areas, they're refusing to leave their barracks. It's politically unacceptable to use the army for the task which lies ahead.
Tudor suggests that we set up an anti-Sinn Féin force distinct from the army and the constabulary, and so free to play the enemy at his own game.
We will need gallant men to carry out that policy.
I want you to recruit such a force. The kind of thing that is going on in Ireland can only be met by reprisals.
What's the Galloper on about this time?
The bold Lord Chancellor would like to hang us all from lampposts.
That Birkin head is a right shite.
Jesus. Is anybody carrying any papers?
I have the command codes for Cork County.
Give them here to me, quick. Just pull up nice and gentle. Cooperate with them now. Nice as pie.
Hey, gentlemen.
Good day, Captain. Are they at it again?
Usual stuff. You know the form?
Sweet.
Thank you. Who's that one, Sergeant?
Seems to be a mate of the captain's.
Car and passengers all right, sir.
Why wouldn't they be? The result of the rebels' activities is to make it impossible for decent citizens like myself and my friends to enjoy a day in the country without having to hard put crossways in us.
Only doing our duty?
Glad we are that ye are. Safe home to you now.
Smoothly away now.
Jesus, Mick, you've got some nerve.
Ah, you stupid whores! You had Margaret Collins by the short hairs and you let him go! Oh,
you said in your speech at the Guildhall, we have murder by the throat. I say we do not.
The Black Intents are achieving some remarkable results.
They're a rabble that you put in as a police force. They are not answerable to the Army High Command, who have been provoked beyond endurance.
We are winning the battle there.
No, we are not, sir. Michael Collins is destroying our intelligence network with impunity. His thugs assassinate our agents, and the Tans burn a village in reprisal. It is the business of the government to govern. If Collins and his men ought to be murdered, then the government ought to murder them.
Field Marshal Wilson, that is the most outrageous statement.
If these things have to be done, then my men must know you are behind them. They have remained disciplined, but all soldiers are at the breaking point.
You are saying that the forces of the Crown cannot deal with a mere gunman.
Know your enemy, sir. Michael Collins is not a simple gunman. When De Valera was in America, Collins took over his duties as president.
Not a title we recognize.
Collins is also president of the Irish Republican Brotherhood. And all of this he manages whilst on the run with a price on his head.
You know, you sound like you admire the man.
I detest the very thought of him. And I'll see him hang in Kilmainham Jail.
Do you want martial law declared in Ireland?
Should you do so, will you stand behind General MacCready when he has to shoot 100 Sinn Feiners a day over there? Because it will come to that. You have to go all out or get out.
Damn and blast all frost.
I have some letters for you to sign. Field Marshal did not look best pleased.
Field Marshal is not objective in regard to Ireland. Sympathies lie with the Protestants in the north.
And he hates all politicians, you most of all.
Smuts has been talking to the King. He suggests we use the occasion of the opening of the Ulster Parliament by the King to break the Irish deadlock.
Is that why the Field Marshal was so angry?
I didn't mention that suggestion to him. Ask Mr. Jones to step in, would you?
Is His Majesty agreeable?
It appears so. You've said many times we would never sit down with murderers, you know?
If it was set in train by the King, you could hardly refuse.
DJ, would the British public stand for me negotiating with the Irish? Would they storm Downing Street should I invite them here?
Whom you invite might dictate the response.
De Valera.
Acceptable, I think.
Michael Collins.
He has a certain romantic appeal, the Dublin Pimpernel, that sort of thing. But I'm afraid the newspapers would be inclined to make hay with him as the leader of a bunch of assassins. Unacceptable, I'd say.
Can De Valera reach any agreement without the consent of Collins?
I suppose not. I would suggest, Prime Minister, that that is their problem, not yours.
Stretch out the hand of forbearance and conciliation, to forgive and to forget, and to join in making for the land which they love a new era of peace, contentment, and goodwill. The future lies in the hands of my Irish people themselves.
Who arrested him?
The army.
The king stands here in Belfast, appealing for conciliation and negotiation, and those damn fools down in Dublin arrest the only man we can negotiate with.
I have reason to believe that you are Eamon de Valera, supposed president of the supposed Republic of Ireland. Are you the person so described?
I am de Valera. I am the president of the declared Republic of Ireland.
You are the president of a band of brigands and assassins. Lock him up.
Mr. De Valera, there has been an error of judgment. Your release will be effected as soon as it is possible. In the meantime, you will be removed to more respectable quarters. Is that not so, Colonel?
If those are your orders, yes, sir.
That is one of my young officers. 2 days ago, he went for a drive in the Dublin mountains with 2 lady friends. He was murdered in full view of them.
Many young men die in war.
War? You call shooting from behind hedges and stone walls war?
Isn't that just as good a protection as hedges and stone walls? How can you hide behind that and fire on the Irish people?
Have the decency to wait until the coffin is in the chapel before you take your leave.
Penny for them.
The Irish.
You led the people to victory during the Great War. You can lead them through this.
The country was united in its desire to defeat Germany. It has never been united on Ireland. My government is a shaky coalition which I barely hold together. It would tremble on this issue and more than likely bring me down.
This is not the Welsh wizard speaking.
Ah, my dear Percy, you're a tonic. I always listen to you.
Then go your own way, as usual. We must eat. Your family will be here at 4.
You staying?
No. I think I should go back to London.
Oh, this looks appetizing indeed. I must get Birkenhead on my side. This implacable enemy of Irish independence will sit down with De Valera. The diehard unionists will feel their interests are being protected.
We have to entice the Turks. Show we can offer them more than the Bolsheviks can.
Well, the alternative is we support Greece with money, munitions, aeroplanes, and we blockade Turkey.
With a hostile Turkey, I do not believe we shall ever have peace in Egypt. Or Mesopotamia, or India.
My dear Birkenhead, such is the price of empire.
Does this cabinet believe we can succeed in coercing Ireland? Or indeed, should we do so?
If they continue to challenge us in our vital interests, if they insist on a form of independence which threatens the defense of this country, then I will not only coerce them, I will beat them into the ground. But if financial considerations such as free trade and sanctions, etc., are the only outstanding problems, then I would not be prepared to go on with repression.
Prime Minister, how do you see us following the King's initiative with advantage?
I propose sending a letter to Craig as the Northern Ireland Premier and to De Valera, inviting them to a conference to explore the possibility of a settlement.
As the Conservative and Unionist members of this cabinet, Such an action might have grave risks for Birkenhead and myself.
His Majesty is anxious that his appeal should be followed up.
I'm in favor. It would dissipate the apparently harsh disparity between the King's appeal and my speech to the Lords. It was unfortunate they should come within a day of one another. I did rather hammer that we should continue coercion, at whatever sacrifice, to prevent Irish independence.
I think it was helpful they came so close together. In dealing with the Irish, you must show that you mean to go on.
We can do nothing but gain from sending such a letter. If De Valera rejects it, it strengthens our position.
To Mr. Eamon De Valera, etc., etc. Sir, the British government are deeply anxious that, as far as they can assure it, the King's appeal for reconciliation in Ireland shall not have been made in vain.
We cannot accept this letter. It's a typical piece of Lloyd George chicanery. If I accept it, I have tacitly accepted partition.
Throw it in the waste paper basket. Let's continue the war and have no truck with negotiation.
We must stand on the rock of an independent, united republic. This whole approach is a trap.
I am aware of the dangers. Lloyd George would like to be the arbiter between myself and Sir James Craig, as if we were two disputing subjects of the British Crown. He will deal with me only as the leader of this nation, and as the leader of the whole of this nation.
That letter offers safe conduct to our representatives, should we send a delegation to London. It does not stop the killing on the streets of Dublin.
What would you ask for?
A truce as a precondition to any conference. For that, we will need the cooperation of Collins and the IRB.
The Irish Republican Brotherhood are a law unto themselves.
They have infiltrated their men into the top echelons of the army. They take their orders from Collins, not from the Army High Command. We have to face that reality, Cahill.
I am the Minister for Defense, and by God, they will take their orders from me. It's time you made that clear to Collins, Chief.
Michael and I are not quite seeing eye to eye of late.
You cannot negotiate a truce without Collins' cooperation.
Cahill Brewer is for going on with the war.
Brewer doesn't know his arse from his elbow. And I've always admired that man. He's given more for Ireland than any of us. But the idea that we can take on the might of the British Empire in a straight fight is balls allergy.
I cannot go to London without there being a truce declared. What is the position of the IRB?
I'll give you my assessment of the position. In some areas, we're down to counting bullets. We lost more men in that abortive attack on the customs house, which you insisted on, than we've lost in 40 operations.
It gained us worldwide sympathy.
Men went into that battle with only 4 rounds of ammunition. If the British knew how perilous our position is, they'd be for going on, as Brew is.
What is it you want, Michael?
We're not strong enough to rely on force alone. We've driven them to the table, so let's talk to them.
On the basis of a republic?
We must achieve the maximum limit of freedom.
Should I go to London, I will take Arthur Griffith, Barton, and possibly Stack.
Griffith and Barton are in jail.
We will get them and everyone else out.
Are you saying I shouldn't go?
Yes.
God damn it, I've brought them to the table.
You will be of more value as the spectre back in Dublin.
Do as you will. You always do. But remember this. A truce will force us all out into the open, like rabbits coming out of their holes. We won't be a secret army anymore. So you see that you come back from London with something definite from your talks.
Take care of yourself now, Mr. Griffiths.
You've been very kind to me, John.
You're welcome.
Well, well, how nice to see you. Good morning, John. How are you? I'm very well, thank you. Thank you very much. Accommodation rather more cramped than log house, but otherwise, well,
isn't it grand to be able to sit here and not be worried about them bastards roaring into the streets?
Two of my lads is in their graves. The third is above in Mountjoy Jail singing rebel songs.
This is what they died for, missus. So we could sit in our own street. And this, praise be to God, is what your third will be singing about tonight.
This truce is only the first move, but if it breaks, the British will pour more troops in here than we've ever dreamed of.
Enjoy the feeling, Mick. If 1,000 blackened hands came around that corner, I couldn't lay a finger on you tonight.
British will get ready in case the truce breaks. We must do the same. There are rough seas ahead, my boy.
One Monday morning, high upon the gallows tree, Kevin Barry gave his young life for the cause of liberty. Just a lad of 18 summers.
Cheer up, Mick. Tonight's victory is ours, and the country's united.
Ah, but at this moment, we're more divided than we've ever been. Find more agreement in hell.
Let's go to the Gresham and have ourselves a warm.
Some say Dev won't let Collins go to London.
Who says?
Where was Dev when Collins was running the black and tanned ragged? Tell me that.
Where was Moses when the light went out? In the dark, missus.
In the dark.
God bless De Valeris.
And God save Michael Collins.
Ah, God bless the lot of them, for this fire is going out. Get up now, for this is not worth bringing back into the house anybody. Come on, come on.
Give me a hand, Harry.
That should do the trick. We must impress on Mr. De Valera the greatness of the British Empire and the fact that the king sits at its head. They must be made to acknowledge the king.
And Sir James Craig?
First De Valera, then I'll deal with the Ulsterman.
The cars are arriving, Prime Minister.
History. A moment of history.
Suspended room, Mr. De Valera. These walls have witnessed countless great moments in history. The British Empire is a sisterhood of nations, a great world. Look at this table. There sits Africa, English and Boer. There sits Canada, French, Scots, and English. There sits Australia, representing many nations. There sits India. Here sit the representatives of England, Scotland, and Wales. All we ask you to do is to take your place in this sisterhood of free nations. It is an invitation, Mr. De Valera. We invite you here.
The problem of Ulster has to be faced.
Left to ourselves, there would be no problem.
The government of Northern Ireland cannot be abrogated without its consent. A partition of Ireland is a fact of life.
Our view is that the issue is not one between Dublin and Belfast. It is between Dublin and the English Parliament.
Now, Belfast has a parliament and a prime minister, Sir James Craig.
Which the English created. The English created the problem, exploited the problem, and continue to do so.
You, Mr. Childers, are the only Englishman in this room.
I must carry out the will of my people, and what the people of Ireland want is a republic. Can you not concede, at any rate, the name republic?
That is just what you cannot have. The people of this country will not tolerate it, after all that has happened.
How much do the people of this country really care about Ireland? More importantly, beyond the cartoon caricatures, how much do they know about us?
Mr. De Valera, you are a Gaelic revivalist.
Our language is another precious part of our heritage you have destroyed as a deliberate act of policy.
Be that as it may, must we not admit, between ourselves, that as in Welsh, there is no strictly accurate word in the Irish language for republic.
Some people use poblacht, which is a recently coined word. The purists favor Seerstadt.
Which is the heading on your notepaper, Seerstadt Héireann. Would you be kind enough to give me a precise translation?
Strictly, it means free state.
Then why insist on republic? Seerstadt is good enough, surely.
What do you think the people will accept?
The people are a bit like sheep, in that they run after each other.
Ah, come and meet Mr. De Valera, my dear.
Please, don't disturb your pose. It annoys John so. It's a great honor and pleasure to meet you, sir.
And I, you. I've heard a great deal about you, Lady Lavery, and your love for Ireland is well known.
Peace in Ireland is my heart's desire, Mr. De Valera. Do sit. John fidgets so when he has a brush in his hand. I'm told the conference is going well.
We're still talking anyway.
I would dearly love to give a dinner party for you. There are many people I should like you to meet.
That is kind of you, but my time is short.
I would like some more of Mr. De Valera's time, but he'll only allow me this one sitting.
You have a fine head, sir. An intellectual head.
What is wrong with Dominion status?
That is not what is on offer. These proposals contain restrictions unknown in any form of Dominion Home Rule. They include continued naval facilities, rights of recruiting, restrictions as to the number of the Irish armed forces, no fiscal autonomy, no right to impose our own custom dues. And finally, we must allow for full recognition of the existing powers and privileges of the Parliament of Northern Ireland, which cannot be abrogated except by its own consent.
Mr. De Valera, I should be sorry if this conference breaks down. I hesitate to think of the horror should war break out again in Ireland.
That is a threat of force, of coercion.
Will you take these proposals back to your people in Dublin for discussion?
I could not and will not advise my people to accept anything that is in that document.
Very well. There's only one thing left for us to discuss.
What is that?
When the truce should come to an end. never dealt with a more infuriating man. He never sticks to a point, refuses to face facts, and at the drop of a hat lectures me on Irish history. Talking to him is like trying to pick up mercury with a fork.
Will he take the proposals to Dublin?
He agreed to, but only after I threatened to cancel the truce. Then he left the damn document behind.
He's bluffing.
I don't want to address the McCurdy dinner tonight. I'm too tired and I have no speech prepared. Have we had a reply from Craig?
Yes.
What is the gist?
He's sitting on his loyalist rock. He intends to keep his six counties.
De Valera sitting on his Republican stone. What a pair. What a country.
Mr. De Valera has sent a messenger for the proposal document.
Has he now?
How very Irish.
In these proposals, the British government have attempted no more than the broad outline of a settlement. The details they leave for discussion when the Irish people have signified their acceptance of the principle of this pact. 10 Downing Street, July 20th, 1921.
The Irish people would crucify us were we to accept a single clause in that document.
They've left the door open. Would you not agree, Mr. Childress?
It is, of course, the opening shot, but it is clearly a shot across the bows of the Republic.
Shot across the bows. It will sink the Republic.
We have done our best, and I've never undertaken to do more than my best.
We have proclaimed a Republic in arms. It has been ratified by the votes of the people, and we have sworn to defend it with our lives.
The oath to the Republic never conveyed any more to me than to do my best in whatever circumstances might arise.
You have accepted a position of authority and responsibility in the government of the Republic. And you will discharge the duties of that office as they have been defined. I do not want ever again to hear anything else from you.
I should like to go through it word by word.
I swear to God, it's himself. But you wouldn't be just sitting there.
Well, I'm going to find out anyway.
Just you watch me. Would you like some more coffee, Mr. Collins?
I might be Jim Murphy from Wicklow.
Ah, go on. Don't kid me. Don't be a louser. You're yourself, aren't you?
Oh, I'm myself right enough.
I knew it. God, my dad would be mad jealous that I had a word at you.
Give your dad my best as well. Bring us some more coffee now.
Lloyd George has thrown the whole thing back at us.
It's only what was expected. They won't fall for what Dev is trying to pull. What do they say?
This is the key phrase. No British government can consider the claim that we should acknowledge the right of Ireland to secede from her allegiance to the King.
I don't want to go to war again. I don't believe we can win it.
You said this to Dev?
I have to be very careful what I say to the Longfella these days. He's given his ear to the Englishman.
Childers.
Never trust a convert. Too much to prove.
Are you ready now, Mr. Collins?
Just leave it there, girl.
Thank you. Lloyd George is on his holidays in Scotland. Boland and McGrath are going there with Dev's reply tonight.
They're wasting their time. If Dev fails,
It'll be...
Me eyes on sweet Molly Malone. She wheeled a wheelbarrow through streets broad and narrow, crying cockles and mussels, alive, alive, oh, alive, alive, oh, alive, alive, oh.
As Mick would say,
ballsology.
I think Dev's gone about it the right way. I thought you were Mick's man.
Your counter-proposals are a disgrace. Paragraph 2 is completely unacceptable. I want it altered or deleted here and now.
We have no authority to do so.
Unless it is withdrawn, conference between us is impossible. From the very outset, I told Mr. De Valera that we look to Ireland to owe allegiance to the throne and to make a future as a member of the British Commonwealth. This letter repudiates that. No conference can take place on this basis.
I want to put pressure on Lloyd George by announcing our London envoys.
They will have plenipotentiary status.
Yes. I want you to go.
Are you two going? Dev, you are my chief, and if you tell me to go, I'll go. But I know, and you know, that I can't bring back a republic.
And where's the point in going?
We will negotiate for external association.
I smell betrayal.
Whatever they agree to in London will have to be ratified back home.
I'm not entirely clear what you mean by external association.
That is me in the straitjacket of the Republic. I must get out of it. That is external association. The purpose of it is to bring Cathal Brua along. That is where we'll eventually get to.
We exchanged a dozen letters and telegrams, and we're no closer than we were 2 months ago.
I do not believe De Valera will be moved on any of the essential points until the conference begins. We are in a classic impasse.
And let's break it.
Oh, how?
By pointing out to that pedantic schoolmaster that the recognition he requires, no British government can accord. On this point, they must have no possible doubt. Our position, His Majesty's government's position, is fundamental to the existence of the British Empire. And we cannot alter it.
Well, that'll only add to the impasse.
No. In the same letter, we send them a fresh invitation, ignoring the whole correspondence to date. I must get De Valera to the table.
You have to hand it to Dan. He's won a conference without preconditions.
Not quite.
Carl, I left the minutes in the cab.
He hasn't given an inch on the Republic.
He hasn't given an inch on the Empire.
On the basis of the new invitation, I will support us going to London.
Good.
You can't be serious.
And
who the hell is
going to
lead the delegation?
No. I don't understand any of it. You insisted you went to London in July, and that I stayed here. Now you're insisting on the reverse.
The situation is completely different now. It is simply a better tactic for me to be here and for you to go to London.
The spectre at the feast. You know what happens when you sup with the devil?
They will not corrupt you.
You haven't my meaning at all. If you sup with the devil, you get to know him. They will get to know me. Rightly or wrongly, I am their devil. I smashed their secret service. I made their blackened hands fear for their lives. I am the elusive Pimpernel they could ever capture or defeat. All of this their newspapers made me. I am the only unknown quantity you have. You put my clogs under that table in Downing Street, and they will see what clay my feet are made of.
It is because they see you as the devil incarnate I want you to go. The plenipotentiaries can bring back from London far more than a mighty army or navy might ever win for us. I need you at that table. They're waiting for us, Michael. We must go in.
And with all that, you still won't go yourself. The president of the people won't represent the people.
I have given you my reasons. On August the 26th, the Dáil, you among them, formally elected me as president of the Irish Republic. As such, I am no longer just the head of Sinn Féin, but the head of state and the symbol of that republic.
All the more reason for you to go.
I must never be seen to compromise that position.
Karl Brewer will not go. Austin Stack will not go. You will not go. Do the diehards of the Republic know something that Michael Collins does not?
And you for the Republic also?
Are you ordering me to go?
I cannot order you. I can only request.
I am being sent to London to do a thing which those who sent me know have to be done, but haven't the courage to do themselves.
I will not give a drink to a man who keeps his coat on in my house. Dev telephoned. He told me to persuade you to go to London. Is he definitely not going himself?
We just had a cabinet meeting out in Black Rock. Griffiths, myself, and Cosgrave are for him going. Barton, Brewer, and Stack, of course, were for him not going. He used his own casting vote as president to decide the issue.
Who will lead the delegation?
He used his own casting vote. Have you ever heard the like? Griffith will lead.
Dev has set the trap, and I've tumbled right into it. Give me another wallop of that. He's deliberately put together a divided team. Arthur and myself see eye to eye, but Barton and Childers will go against us at every turn. And Dev will sit in our coattails here in Dublin.
How can he? The Dáil have given the plenipotentiaries a free hand to negotiate and report back. Not the cabinet.
Dev has added a letter of instruction. He wants to keep the reins firmly in his hands.
But all that you must go, Mick. We need you there. Ireland needs you there.
Take good care of it, Nate. I'll keep it in the usual place, ready as always.
Take it home with you. It's a steed I no longer need. Steed indeed, no longer needed. A pike, a staff, no longer... I am no longer the man on the bicycle. I don't want to see it here when I come out. Sell it, take it home, or throw it in the Liffey. But have a car for me when I come out.
So you, the Supreme Council of the Irish Republican Brotherhood, pledged to fight for a republic, are asking me, your president, to negotiate with the British when they have made it crystal clear a republic is not on offer.
Ever since I got back from America, it has been clear to me that we cannot overthrow the British militarily. If it's a question between peace and war, I am for peace. I think you should go, Mick, and I'll tell you for why. A gunman will screw better terms out of them than an ordinary politician.
Is that Harry Borland talking now? Well, do I hear an echo of the lamp flare?
There's no echo there, Dick.
Not until the cute whore.
These are my conditions. I will not travel with the rest of the delegation. I will not stay with them in London. I want my own house. I want my own staff. I want you, Emmett, and you, Bill, as my personal escort. I want Eddie from the Gresham to run the kitchens.
You will keep us informed.
Informed is not the word. I will send you daily dispatches, and you will do the same from here. I want to know every twist and turn they get up to at home. I may be sitting in London, but this organization stays on a war footing until I tell you otherwise.
Watch they don't make a scapegoat out of you, Mick.
Slana, will you?
Good luck.
Good luck, boys.
Good luck. Good
luck. I'll let them make a scapegoat out of me. Someone has to go.
We've made inquiries of our friend in Canada. He can have a plane standing by at Croydon Aerodrome for as long as you want.
They wouldn't dare touch you, Mick.
If the talks and the troops break down, Field Marshal Wilson will find an excuse to have me arrested and shot. I want that plane at Croydon.
Right.
You know what it means if I put my foot on this, Pat?
The beginning of a great and historic journey.
The beginning of compromise?
No.
What do you think the people of this country will do if the man who comes back from London with less than a republic?
The diehards will crucify him.
Don't you think Dev knows that? Oh, well. Never let it be said your mother raised a gibber.
Plenipotentiaries have full powers as defined in their credentials. 2. It is understood before decisions are finally reached on a main question that a dispatch notifying the intention to make these decisions will be sent to members of the cabinet in Dublin and that a reply will be awaited by the plenipotentiaries before final decision is made. 3. It is also understood that the complete text of the draft treaty about to be signed will be similarly submitted to Dublin and a reply awaited. 4. It is understood the cabinet in Dublin will be kept regularly informed of the progress of the negotiations.
Delegation of plenipotentiaries.
Mr. Arthur Griffin.
Mr. Griffin.
Michael Collins.
Mr. Collins.
Mr. Lloyd-George.
Mr. Collins, Lord Birkenhead, Mr. Churchill.
Mr. Churchill.
Gertie, they're back!
Too bad, girl. Not too bad.
Well, I think we got off to a reasonable start.
Train, Terrace.
Nuts and bolts start. I'm left with the impression they're anxious for peace.
On whose terms? The Welsh wizards?
Mr. Lloyd George is a remarkably suave and astute man.
We didn't get near the nub of the matter.
Yes, the sailing will get rougher when we get to the Crown and Ulster. I must make my report to the chief. Childers, will you let me have your notes for enclosure? Yes, I think you could say we scored today. Nothing.
Oh, Mr. Collins, there was a telephone call today from Sir John Lavery. You know the painter? He would consider it an honour if you'd sit for him. So we should, too.
They say Lady Lavery's a stunner.
What you know? I hear you're well spoken for.
Don't believe all you hear.
What do you make of the day, Mick?
I wouldn't trust any of them as far as I could throw them.
Arthur is being a trifle optimistic in thinking we scored a single point today.
I've watched many a gamekeeper lay snares. The good ones leave no trace of the trap.
England's policy in the past has been to treat Ireland as a conquered and subject country. If there is a change in the policy of subordinating Ireland to English interests, then there appears to be possibility of peace. But we have had broken treaties in the past.
You've never made a treaty with the people of this country before. Treaties in the past have been with oligarchies ruling this country. This is your first chance of having a treaty with the people.
You speak of breaches of the truce on our side. This is a document from your GHQ giving the military and the police the idea that the renewal of fighting is inevitable, and giving directions for, I quote, hunting down the rebels as soon as the peace breaks down, and giving them no peace until all important leaders have been arrested or satisfactorily accounted for. Is that kind of thing conducive to the success of these talks?
At the moment, I don't know that this was issued.
We know. You can't issue documents like that in Ireland without my knowledge.
Like the Prime Minister, I have no knowledge of this document. But it would be foolish in the extreme for the military not to be prepared for a breakdown of these negotiations. I have no doubt that you have made your own plans, Mr. Collins.
And I have no doubt that you are aware of them, since I am followed night and day. Even to Mass yesterday at Maiden Lane Church. I do hope your Secret Service has the sensitivity to send a Catholic agent to Mass with me. I wouldn't like to be responsible for conversion as well as subversion.
Can we move on to the matter of Ulster?
who's at the door?
The Mr. Michael Collins.
Was he expected?
No, ma'am. Sir John has taken him to the studio.
Are you offering me the whole of London?
I will invite anyone who can help your cause. I'm not sure any of the die-hard conservatives will cross this wicked threshold.
You keep a wicked house then, do you?
Oh, Hazel is notorious. Did you know she helped Mr. Shaw write his Intelligent Woman's Guide to Socialism?
I would not dare help such a man write. He was kind enough to send me chapters for perusal, and occasionally I ventured a comment.
I never missed a Shaw play when I lived in London.
I hadn't known you lived here.
When I was 15, I was sent over to work in the Post Office Savings Bank. I spent 9 years here.
Which is your favorite Shaw piece?
I liked Widower's Houses a great deal. And Candida. But I don't think Mary O'Neill was the correct thing for the name part. They say you can take the man out of West Cork, but you can never take West Cork out of the man. Would you care to call me Mike or no?
Is that what your friends call you?
Mick is more usual.
Then I should call you Mick.
You should understand the political risk we are taking with this conference. We are placing the very life of this government in jeopardy. We must now know where we stand. Whether allegiance to the king is to be finally repudiated by you, or whether you're prepared to be associated like the other dominions in the community of nations known as the British Empire. To put it bluntly, will you be British subjects or foreigners? You must be one or the other.
Hmm? I must make the British understand that we are ready for all-out war. Answer me, Francis. Will I burn in hell for such a decision?
Of all the men I know, you most abhor violence.
Yet I must threaten it. I must play the card that will turn world opinion against Britain, taking the risk of sending the cream of our young men to their deaths.
Given certain circumstances, war can be just.
I intend sending this to our delegation in London. We are all here at one that there can be no question of our asking the Irish people to enter an arrangement which would make them subject to the Crown or demand from them allegiance to the British King. If war is the alternative, we can only face it.
There is no iota of doubt about this. This letter of theirs is an instruction. One which I am not prepared to accept, because inevitably it puts me in the wrong. You get Kathleen in here, and tell her to inform them that I am going home. Let him come over here, talk to the British himself.
The British have never said to us that the alternative is war, so at the moment, we don't have to face that possibility.
Dev is instructing us to tell the British that the alternative to allegiance is war.
We've all taken an oath to the Republic, and we cannot go back on that.
Balls, allergy chillers. We all know the British will never accept a republic. Dev knows it too.
External association.
It's a non-starter. It threatens the very existence of their empire. We are not going to get a bloody republic.
I think you should bring us back to the point, Arthur.
I see the chief's letter as an attempt to curb our powers as plenipotentiaries.
We are under instructions from the cabinet as well as the Doyle.
Don't be a pettifogging attorney, Duffy. We were given plenipotentiary powers by the Parliament in Dublin, not by the cabinet. Those powers empower us to negotiate a treaty. Then have it ratified by the Parliament, not by the Cabinet.
I want that letter from the Chief refuted by us all, in the strongest possible terms.
Progress, Michael.
I feel totally hamstrung by the Dublinites. It's not just that one letter from Dev. You know that thing when you used to walk in a line at school and the kid behind you flicked your ankle with the toe of his boot? If it was skillfully done, you could never turn around and accuse him. But you kept nearly falling over all the same.
What would you settle for? That Spalpeen was not behind you.
The idea of a 26-county Ireland without a single English soldier or civil servant in it, imperfect as it may be, is a great attraction. It could be the stepping stone to a unified and free.
We are here to decide the future of our country. It's an awesome responsibility, which I feel keenly, more so because we're so divided amongst ourselves as to our aims.
It's you and me will have to make the decision in the end.
God help us when we do.
I'm going to Dublin this weekend to see Dev.
Only Dev?
When I was young, I read every word you wrote. I thought of you as Ireland.
No one man is Ireland.
Do you know what the Longfellow has no grasp of at all? English politics. He has no notion of how rocky Lloyd George's position is.
Why do you think that is?
I think he believes that if a man has led his country through a war, as Lloyd George has, then his people will follow him, wherever he wants to take them.
You're not really talking about the British Prime Minister, are you?
That's too deep for me, Arthur. I'm just a simple country lad.
Obviously be the misunderstanding, Michael.
Your letter was interpreted as an attempt to curb our powers to negotiate.
You are only limited by those conditions set down in your original instructions. Of course, a cabinet decision cannot be withdrawn or varied except by the cabinet as a whole.
That letter was not from the cabinet. It was from you personally.
Now, Michael, memos of mine, except I explicitly state otherwise, are nothing more than an attempt to keep you in touch with the views of the members of the cabinet here on the various points as they arise.
What do you want us to do?
To carry on as you are. To get the best for Ireland.
That's what we're trying to do.
I would never doubt any of you in that respect.
I want to know, should all this go wrong, who is for me and who is against? I want accurate estimates of men and arms. I want to know what local commanders I can count on and which ones I can't trust. I don't want opinion. I don't want wishful thinking. I want to know precisely what our military position is.
What if an agreement is reached, but the border remains?
Then as the legitimate government of the rest of the country, it will be up to us, not the British, to remove it.
Stand up.
Take your
head. Back to London, Mr. Collins.
Like a pendulum, Neil. The clock stops. I'll be stuck in the middle of the Irish Sea.
You say Churchill and Birkenhead will be there.
And a few others. Will you come and bring Arthur? Why did you do that?
It irritates them. We'll come and eat our food.
I don't suppose you met Lord Fritsch during his time in Dublin?
No. But I did come close to him at one point.
Oh? When was that?
Oh, a few months ago. You were walking by yourself near the Viceregal Lodge.
I liked to do that. Drove the security fellows crazy.
They were right. We had you surrounded. But I called the boys off because it seemed such a brave thing for you to do.
London's the best place, after all, to meet people. For some time, I was on the heels of De Wet in South Africa. But only caught up with him here at dinner.
There's more than a stretch of water between them and us, Arthur.
They want to break the deadlock.
You know.
They're suggesting meetings, just with the two of us.
The others won't like it.
I've agreed to it, but I'm not happy about it, Bob.
A few smaller meetings might push things along.
Sub-conferences, that's what we've agreed to. Sub-conferences.
Arthur and Mick have agreed to keep us fully informed.
I have a bad feeling about it.
Find a needle in a haystack, which would be hard put to identify a single strand of hay.
We were looking for the devil incarnate. It seems that our chaps were seeking to identify you by your horns.
Might I suggest, Griffith, that we repair and leave the caliper with the man on the bike?
Receiver, show the Prime Minister and Mr. Griffith to the drawing room. More than anyone, the Prime Minister wants these talks to succeed. You do appreciate that.
We cannot give way on an All-Ireland Parliament.
I'm not asking you to do that. I worked out something which I think you will be able to accept. We do indeed establish such a Parliament.
How do you persuade Ulster to come in?
With the following proviso.
If after the first 6 months, or before the end of 12 months, Ulster wants to withdraw, they may do so, but only by coming back into the UK. Now, while she is part of the All-Irish Parliament, she will be paying a great deal less in taxation. But on returning to the UK, that will almost double.
So, the lower taxation is your carrot.
I know these people. They have their hands on their hearts, but if it comes to touching their pockets, they very quickly drop their hands on them. If they spent a year paying lower taxes, they will not volunteer again for the higher ones.
The problem is that within the six-county area, as defined by you, there are two predominantly Catholic and Nationalist counties.
Then let's discuss a boundary commission.
You're a practical man, Mick. So am I. The Crown is sacred to us, a republic to you. How are we to bridge that gap?
Why don't you order Sir James Craig and his unionists to come to heel?
I said you were a practical man. You know we cannot compel them by force of arms.
So do they. Which is the card they always play. A peculiar card. They will take arms against the Crown to stay loyal to the Crown.
The British people would not tolerate the army moving against loyalists.
That's not it at all. You can't be sure would the army stand for it. You might have another Coral Mutiny in your hands.
They have to be persuaded in.
Your own Commander-in-Chief, Field Marshal Sir Henry Wilson, stands squarely behind the Unionists. You armed the Ulster Volunteer Force. Half the establishment of this country is behind Craig and his Unionists, and he knows it.
You must let us deal with that aspect of it. The killing must not be resumed.
What made you change your mind?
You did. You made me realize we cannot keep Ireland in a permanent state of subjugation. These talks must not fail. For both our own sakes and the sakes of our countries.
Does this embody your understanding with the Prime Minister?
Has he approved it?
Yes.
Griffith has agreed to my suggestion, and we will do the Ulsterman in. I saw Bonnelaw this afternoon, and he will recommend it.
All of it?
Yeah, well, I didn't tell him the taxation part. The beauty of it is, Ulster will accept it because they will believe the Sinn Féiners will reject it.
But Griffith has already accepted it.
The Ulstermen don't know that.
It's very subtle, David.
It's better than that. Don't you see, by agreeing to a boundary commission to set the limits of Ulster, Griffith has accepted its existence. He can no longer break an Ulster, and he does not want to break in the crown.
How was the trip, sir?
Oh, the crossing was a bit rough. And that journey from Holyhead to Euston is interminable.
Then you cannot have impressed on him how concerned we are.
I told Dev that I had come to Dublin to inform him that in our view, the sub-conferences between Arthur Mick and selected members of the British side were usurping the powers of the delegation as a whole.
What exactly did he say?
He said he was aware of the work Arthur and Mick were doing and was in no way worried about the situation.
Sometimes the way the chief's mind works is a complete mystery to me.
Gentlemen, these negotiations have now been in progress for over 6 weeks. I propose this draft document be our final offer to the Irish delegation, and that they take this document to Dublin for approval, and it is signed or not later than a week from today. Must be impressed upon them that their deadline is absolute.
You are asking that the full delegation go to Dublin?
Yes.
What is the object of such an exercise? This is not the final British offer.
I believe that it is. I believe that is what we sign or reject. We are under instruction to ask the Dublin Cabinet's opinion before taking a grave decision. I believe that such a decision now has to be taken, and I want it taken by us all, or rejected by us all.
We've made them a reasonable offer, dominion status within the empire like Canada. In return, they have to recognize the crown and give us some guarantees on defense.
What the hell happened, Mick? The executive have been waiting for you down at the Gresham since 9 o'clock.
You won't believe this. The bloody mail boat hit a fishing smack. Three poor buggers died in the smack. That's a copy of the treaty. I want the lad's opinion of it by 1 o'clock.
I do not agree with Mr. Griffith's assessment. I do not believe a rejection of these proposals will mean war.
England is bluffing.
Not a bit of it. I believe this document is England's last word on the subject. And if we refuse, the consequences are not to be thought of.
Michael.
Rejecting this treaty would be a great gamble. England could start a war here within a week. We have 12 months before the Oath of Allegiance comes into force. I believe it is worth the risk to see how the arrangement works.
No. Those are my sentiments also.
If we press a bit more, we'll get further concessions on trade and defense.
The right to defend ourselves is being denied by the stipulation giving Britain the exclusive right to defend Irish coastal waters.
The word exclusively must, of course, come out. But I have to say, I think it natural for them to demand facilities on our coast as being necessary.
I have a question for you people. Who was responsible for the sub-conference setup getting started that resulted in you two doing most of the talking for the rest of them?
The suggestion came from the British.
They selected their men well.
You will withdraw that slanderous accusation.
I will not. It's no more than the truth.
You will not impugn my character, nor that of Mr. Collins. I insist you withdraw your unfounded allegation.
There was two of you in it right enough.
If you don't like it, blow up. Get another five to go over. Better still, go yourself.
I will not have the private proceedings of the delegation discussed here. I must most strongly make the point that Mr. Griffith and Mr. Collins agree to sub-conferences with the knowledge and consent of the full delegation.
Precisely. Ah, come on, lads. There's no need for this.
I ask that my remark be withdrawn.
That is not sufficient. I demand your withdrawal be minuted.
The Council unanimously disapproved of the three clauses relating to the oath, coastal defences, and partition.
Advisor at one with the cabinet there.
We drafted an alternative form of words for the oath, which the council would find acceptable.
Have you got the battalion reports in the north?
They'll be sent direct to you in London.
I want a state of readiness up there. We've got to get back. We have a cabinet meeting in 5 minutes. Meet me at the mailboat tonight. I'll give you a report to the council.
From their side, the British insist that the oath is a political necessity for them.
It's obvious we cannot have anything like "and the king as head of the state and empire." We need a form of words to get Ireland an acceptable, I so-and-so do solemnly swear true faith and allegiance to the Constitution of the Irish Free State, to the Treaty of Association, and to recognize the King of Great Britain as head of the Associated States, the Association of States.
Nothing doing. There's going to be no unanimity on such an oath as that.
Surely, Cahill, you can't object to taking an oath if you agree to association.
I think the chief has a point there, Cahill. That is not an oath to the king as such.
Do you really believe that?
I do, Cahill. I do.
Well, you may as well swear.
The bloody boat if they don't get a move on.
Mr. Griffith, the delegation will return to London and try to get this document amended. Tell them that this cabinet will not accept the oath of allegiance as drafted. And if it is not amended, we will face the consequences, even should that mean war.
I will not accept that. I will not accept that instruction.
I am not instructing you.
You're awful loose with that word, war.
I have said it before, and I say it again. I will not break on the crown.
Mr. President, may I suggest that you return to London with the delegation? It is unfair to put Mr. Griffith in this position.
I will fight for as many concessions as can be got, and then I will sign the treaty and place it before our Parliament and let them decide whether to accept it or reject it, and also decide for or against war. They are the proper body to take such decisions.
Do you not understand that if you sign this thing, you'll split Ireland from top to bottom?
I suppose that's so. Tell you what I'll do. I'll go back to London. I'll not sign the document, but I'll bring it back and submit it to the Dáil. And if necessary, to the people.
If you will inform Lloyd George that the document cannot be signed and state that it is now a matter for the Dáil and try and put the blame on Ulster, then my presence in London is not necessary.
Our presence on that boat is.
Mr. President, if we excise the oath from this draft, does that not mean that we must also exclude the first three clauses, those dealing with dominion status?
Yes, it does.
There's no time now, Sean. I'll send you the details from London. Tell the lads our dad has their views today.
Into Downing Street with new proposals that are just the same as the old ones. Dev has sent them back to argue for external association, an idea that has already been thrown out by the British, absolutely. I wasn't going to waste my time on that one.
You look exhausted.
When I was on the run, I could go for a week without sleep. At any time, I knew I could be captured or worse. It's a form of exhaustion I never thought I'd see equaled.
Now you have.
I don't belong in this nest of singing birds. They chirrup mightily one to the other. And that's the falseness of it all, because no one trusts the other. Lloyd George puts his arm around my shoulder, pulls the old friends act, and a short time ago he'd have had me at the rope's end.
But it's not because of Lloyd George you didn't go to Downing Street.
No. It's clever ality. Childers is another singing board.
How so?
He removed the first three clauses which dealt with dominion status from the British draft. That's what they've gone back in with.
Does he have the authority to do that?
He said Dev agreed to it. Neither myself nor Arthur heard that exchange.
Mr. Shaw always gives the best arguments to his villains.
Mr. Shaw is a cleverer man than I am, Gunga Din.
I'm cold, Mick.
of everything we had agreed. It is my view that we must now end it. We must announce to the world that these negotiations have broken down because of the intransigence of the Irish.
We must see to it that they break on the crown.
Then let us wait for them to give us the cue. They surely will.
I have conditionally accepted in my letter to you association with the crown in return for essential unity, which is Craig's turn now. He should write a letter accepting essential unity.
Craig will not write such a letter. We know he is going to refuse these proposals.
Nevertheless, we'll go ahead with them. I cannot understand what your difficulty is in accepting clauses 1, 2, and 3 of our draft.
We should be as closely associated with you in all large matters as the Dominions, and in the matter of defense, still more so. But our difficulty is coming into the Empire.
That ends. Finishes it. This means war.
Well, Duffy, you stupid bastard. Does your mother know you're out? With one remark. You have undone the weeks of good work Collins and myself achieved in hard sub-conferences. Delicate, difficult, careful work trodden on by your great big bogman's boots. But above all, you stupid man, you allowed them to break on crown and empire just when I was working them round to Ulster.
At least we went. Which is more than Collins did.
Tell that to the people who are going to die in Ireland.
I must see Mr. Griffith.
It's all right, Liam. I'll deal with it.
What? Concessions by us would allow you to return to Downing Street.
We have surrendered a great deal. On the King, even a conditional recognition, however shadowy, of Irish national unity in return for our acceptance of the empire. Surely to God, that's not asking too much. If we got that, we could push the whole thing through Dublin in a week.
Craig is an obdurate man.
Making myself calculate, we can only carry half the members of the Dáil. To get a majority, we must have something more to offer them.
How much real power has Collins?
90% of the gunmen will follow Mick. You must help us to get peace.
How?
Get your Prime Minister to meet Collins alone and let them have a heart-to-heart.
Will Collins agree?
I don't know.
Let me show you something.
When we came back from Dublin, all these men had been posted here. And more in Cadogan Gardens. If you were Michael Collins, would you trust the British?
Will you talk to him?
It's 9:25. He's not coming.
Thank you.
Anything else on defense?
I would like Mr. Churchill to define what he means by us allowing care and maintenance parties into our ports.
I think that's quite clear.
Mr. Churchill is quite capable of sending a force of 5,000 soldiers into Cork Harbour to clean the latrines.
Now, Craig?
You must get a definite reply on unity from him. I don't care if he rejects or accepts.
The Boundary Commission?
Yes. If the people of the Northeast are allowed to choose for themselves, counties Tyrone, Fermanagh, parts of Derry, Armagh, and County Down will vote for inclusion in the South. Let Craig try and govern what's left.
It would be an economically unviable area.
Will you make provision in writing in the Articles of Agreement for a Boundary Commission?
Will you accept clauses 1 and 2?
You're asking me to accept a free state within the Empire.
I'm asking you to return here at 2 o'clock with all a part of your delegation.
No offer will be accepted by the nation if that offer deprives us of the essentials of freedom. Now, it is not a hard thing to know what are the essentials of freedom. Freedom is a thing you cannot cut in two. You are either all free or you are not free. It is therefore for complete freedom that we are struggling. And we will tell everybody that this nation will continue to struggle for its freedom until it has got the whole of it.
We come back and back and back to the matter we cannot avoid. That is Craig and unity. Does he accept it or not?
Mr. Griffith, you are letting us down.
Every document we have ever given you was contingent on Irish unity.
Mr. Griffith, in this letter you promised me that you would not let me down on the Boundary Commission and Ulster. Now you're trying to break an Ulster when we all know your real problem lies in Dublin.
What is this letter?
I don't know what the hell it is.
This memorandum written by Thomas Jones and approved by Mr. Griffith on the 13th of November dealt once and for all with the Ulster question. In accepting its contents, Mr. Griffith agreed that the conclusion of these negotiations was not dependent on Sir James Craig's acceptance or not of the essential unity of Ireland. I assumed, Mr. Collins, you were both party to this memorandum. I took the risk of breaking my party. You in Ireland often bring against us in England the charge of breach of faith. Now it is for you to show that Irishmen know how to keep faith.
I have never let a friend or an enemy down on an undertaking. I said I would not let you down on that, and I will not.
Then let us deal with the other matters.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, a world without end. Amen. May God lay his almighty hand over the heads of our men and our country. Can I get you gentlemen anything?
No. Thank you, Kathleen.
We have now given you concessions on your coastal defense, on the wording of the Oath of Allegiance, as you insisted. I will say further that if you sign this treaty, I will also drop our demand for free trade. What is your reply?
I have already said I will not let you down.
Do I understand, Mr. Griffiths, that though everyone else refuses, you will nevertheless agree to sign?
That is so, Mr. Prime Minister.
Your answer, sir.
I have given my answer, but it is not reasonable of you to ask the others to sign until they know Craig's position.
That is not enough. If we sign, we shall sign as a delegation and stake the life of our government upon our signature. Is the Irish delegation prepared to do the same? Mr. Barton, those who are not for peace must take the full responsibility for the war which will immediately follow refusal by any delegate to sign the Articles of Agreement.
We must, Prime Minister, refer this to our Parliament.
There is no must.
I repeat, we must refer to Dublin.
And I repeat, there is no must. I have to communicate with Sir James Craig tonight. Here are the alternative letters which I have prepared. One enclosing the Articles of Agreement reached by His Majesty's government and yourselves, and the other saying that Sinn Féin representatives refuse the oath of allegiance and refuse to come within the empire. If I send this letter, it is war, and war within 3 days. Which letter am I to send? Whichever letter you choose travels by special train to Holyhead and by destroyer to Belfast. The train is waiting with steam up at Euston. If the letter is to reach Sir James Craig in time, we must have your answer by 10 p.m. tonight. You can have until then, but no longer, to decide whether you will give peace or war to your country.
I'm going to sign.
You have done all that you could, David.
Will it be enough, Pussy?
The moment Griffith said he would sign, that was the moment.
Braver man than Arthur Griffith. I've never met.
If it is to be war, Winston, how many men would we need to hold down Southern Ireland?
Well, the highest figure mentioned has been 250,000. I would say that between 150 to 200,000 could do the job.
Get me a sherry. And somebody tell them I'm here.
Bob, consider the terms and concessions we have now got. They are more than any Irishman could have hoped for. Think of the alternative. Think what Mick said to you in the car, how few active volunteers there are. He asked, did you want to send them out to be slaughtered?
Barton, you will be hanged from a lamppost in Dublin if your refusal to sign causes a new war in Ireland.
And me too, I suppose.
Gavin, I was in Mountjoy Jail when they hanged Morn and Flood and the others. I saw the hangman who was going to hang those young lads. And God help me, I never want to see the like of that again.
I don't want to see any more of our young men die any more than you do.
And in the name of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, sign.
I will. But I will sign it in this house. I will not cross the threshold of Downing Street ever again.
I will sign it here also.
You are the last one, Bob. You must hold out.
Despite the consequences.
It is a matter of principle. Hold out. I hear Molly's voice, and she is saying the same.
Really, Erskine, I am very fond of your wife, but hers is not the only voice I have to listen to. I'm going to sign, Erskine.
This leads to a lasting friendship between our two peoples.
I may have just signed my political death warrant.
I have signed my actual death warrant.